Given any polynomial, you can factor out the zeros and get a product like this. As some of the zeros can be complex numbers, it's better to plot a polynomial as a function on the complex plane. The color represents the argument and the brightness the magnitude. Let's now look at rational functions, such as this function. When we look at the polynomial at the denominator, we can again write it as a product of its zeros. When taking the reciprocal of this, the zeros turn into poles. These are exactly the poles of our rational function. When we rewrite the function through a partial fraction decomposition, we get two terms. These are called the principal parts, and they describe how the function behaves near our poles. When changing the principal part, we also change our original function. So what we have done here is to take a rational function and rewrite the denominator as a product. Then we can always find a partial fraction decomposition, and we get at each pole some principal part, which is a polynomial in 1 divided by z minus a. At each pole, we say that the rational function has a value infinity. So the rational function defines a function from the complex plane to the extended complex plane. Many properties of polynomials can be generalized to holomorphic functions. Consider an open and connected subset of the complex numbers. Then a function on that set is called holomorphic if it's everywhere complex differentiable. This condition is a lot stronger than that of real differentiability. So let's look at what properties of polynomials we can generalize to holomorphic functions. The usual form in which polynomials are written is centered at the origin. But we can also always find coefficients which give a form which is centered at any other point. For holomorphic functions, we can always locally represent them as power series. So in some neighborhood of A, f takes the form of a power series centered at A. For non-zero polynomials, there is always a finite set of zeros. For holomorphic functions, the set of zeros is always discrete in its domain. A subset P of U is called discrete in U if P has no limit points in U. That the zero set of a holomorphic function is always discrete is a consequence of the identity theorem. This theorem tells us that if a holomorphic function on an open and connected set is zero on a set with a limit point, then it must be zero everywhere. Notice, however, that the zero set of a holomorphic function can have limit points outside of the domain. For example, in these examples, we have a holomorphic function on the unit disk where zeros have limit points on the boundary of the unit disk. Finally, given any finite set and for each point in that set, multiplicity, you can also find a polynomial which has exactly zeros with the matching multiplicities in this set. The same statement also holds for holomorphic functions, when we replace finite by discrete. This is also known as the Weierstrass factorization theorem. Let's take a look at some examples. First of all, the sine function is holomorphic on the entire complex plane. In this form, the function has exactly simple zeros at every integer. We also have a representation as a product which factors out the zeros. Another function, which is holomorphic on the entire complex plane, is a reciprocal of the gamma function. This has simple zeros at all integers smaller than zero, and we have a corresponding product formula. Let's now look at rational functions. These can be generalized to meromorphic functions. A function is called meromorphic if it has a discrete set of poles and it's holomorphic everywhere else. Meromorphic functions behave a lot like rational functions. For example, a rational function is always a quotient of two polynomials, while a meromorphic function is always a quotient of two holomorphic functions. For rational functions, we always have a finite set of poles, while for meromorphic functions, the set of poles is discrete. Just as with polymorphic functions, the poles can have limit points on the boundary of the domain. Finally, given a finite set of points, and for each point some principal part, we can find a rational function which has exactly poles with the matching principal parts in our set. The same property also holds for meromorphic functions, when we replace finite by discrete. This is known as the Mittag-Leffler theorem. For example, the cotangent is meromorphic on the entire complex plane. In this form, it has poles at every integer, and we get a formula similar to a partial fraction decomposition. Another example of a meromorphic function is this. Here we have poles of order 2 at all integers, which is reflected in this formula. But how do we define the principal parts of a meromorphic function? For holomorphic functions, we can always find a local representation as a power series. It turns out that the same is also true for meromorphic functions when we add some terms with negative exponents if there is a pole. This is known as a Lorentz series. The part with the negative exponents is called the principal part, and the other part, the regular part. For example, this function is meromorphic and has a pole at zero. The second term can be developed into a geometric series. Then we get this Lorentz series at zero. Let's go back to the Mittag-Leffler theorem. So given some domain, a discrete set in the domain, and at each point a principal part, how can we construct a meromorphic function which has poles with their given principal parts? You could try to sum all the principal parts. If we just have a finite set of poles, then this gives us the solution. However, if we have infinitely many poles, then the sum may not converge. To ensure that the sum converges, we are going to introduce additional rational functions which have no poles inside of our domain. Let's look at the simplest case where we just have simple poles. So the principal parts has this form. We can expand 1 over z minus a as a series like this. Then we can approximate this by a rational function whose only pole is in b. We can also expand it as a series without any poles and get this approximation, which we may say has a pole at infinity. Now we can decompose our discrete set in two parts. One of them stays bounded and one goes to infinity. For the bounded part, we choose for every point some point outside of our domain such that the points eventually approach each other. Then we choose high enough orders for our approximation, and we get that this sum converges uniformly on every compact subset. This gives us our meromorphic function. We can apply this to find a meromorphic function on the complex plane which has simple poles at every integer with residue 1. Since this sum converges, we get that we only need one term to ensure convergence. This turns out to be related to the cotangent like this. We can also find a function which has simple poles at every integer and whose residue is 1 or minus 1. Once again, we only need one term to ensure convergence, and we get this formula. This is related to the sine function. Let's now look at the Weierstrass factorization theorem. Here we have to introduce extra factors in the product to ensure convergence. These take the form of this. Now we decompose D again like this, and under certain conditions, we get that this product converges and gives us our holomorphic function with prescribed zeros. We can use this to find a holomorphic function on the complex plane, which has zeros at every integer. Since this sum converges, the following product converges. This is related to the sign like this. We can also find a function with zeros exactly at the negative integers. This turns out to be related to the gamma function. Now let's take a look at an example where the domain is not the entire complex plane, but just the unit disk. For each point in the unit disk, we take one over the conjugate to be its associated point. Then under this condition, we don't need any correction factors in the product. After some simplifications, we get this formula for a holomorphic function on the unit disk with prescribed zeros.